Please stand. Motives to receive and embrace our fellow human beings unconditionally with an open mind. We are well aware that we have alienated and estranged many of them from us due to our righteous, self-righteous attitude and compartmentalized spirituality. May I invite you this evening to enjoy the spirit of Christmas and the excitement of the season. And along with that, I request you to beseech the Almighty to grant us a spiritual alertness that will prepare us well for the arrival of our Savior. During this season, as we decorate our Christmas trees, may the placing of every ornament be an act of a spiritual celebration. As we join together in singing carols, may the glad blending of voices be a model of our cooperative companionship in Jesus Christ. As we watch pageant actors, may the wondrous joy of Jesus' birth nestle into our open and hopeful hearts. And as we light the four candles in the Advent wreath, may the flames serve to ignite his power within us and to assure us of his presence through the the full circles of our lives. While we sing Christmas carols, let us also sing the song of Mary, that he has filled the hungry with good things, and the rich he has sent empty away. Let this song open up our hearts and minds to the thought that as Christians, we are very much accountable for the God-given gifts in the form of talents, treasure, time, or position. As stewards of this divine trust, let us resolve to cultivate a habit of singing and acting Mary's song with a word of kindness, a gift of money, an ear to listen, or a heart to care. There are many around us who are in real need of these things. While we are about to bid farewell to the 2007 and usher ourselves in the new year, let the Mary-like openness of faith, the Joseph-like trust in the Lord, and the shepherd-like eagerness to be with Jesus, and the wise man-like determination to seek the Messiah, guide us into the new year as an ongoing generator of healing, reconciliation, renewal, and encouragement. At the same time, let us be reminded of the fact that the Christian love, gladness, and hope originate in a humble stable, expanded throughout the world, and are durable for ages till eternity. At this time, let us think about the less fortunate people who are unable or deprived of the celebration of this festive season due to various reasons like ill health, poverty, old age, bereavement, or any kind of relationship problems. Advent and Christmas seasons are about touching people or instilling some hope in them and bringing a difference in their life by being with them. There are many people around us who crave for a loving touch. As we know, the celebration of Christmas is marred by the tragedies and that are happening on a day-to-day basis all around the world. Bearing this in mind, let us pray for the regions of the world with political instability, social injustice, religious persecution, war, and terrorism. By remembering the aforementioned things, let us pray silently for 1 or 2 minutes. Beloved in Christ, at this Christmastide, let it be our care and delight to hear again the message of the angels, and in our hearts and minds to go even unto Bethlehem and to see the babe lying in a manger. Let us pray for the needs of the whole world, for peace on earth and goodwill among all his people, for unity and brotherhood within the church he came to build, and especially in this our parish, our diocese, and within our community. And because this would rejoice his heart, let us remember in his name the poor, helpless, the cold, the hungry, and the marginalized, the sick, the lonely, and the unloved, the aged, and the little children, all those who do not know the Lord Jesus, or who do not love him, or who by sin have grieved his heart of love. Lastly, let us remember before God the life, witness, and legacy of all those who rejoice with us, but upon the other shore, and with whom in the Lord Jesus we are one forever. these prayers and praises, let us humbly offer up to the throne of heaven. In the words which Christ himself has taught us, let us join together in Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
God announces in the Garden of Eden that the seed of woman shall bruise the serpent's head. Then the man and his wife heard the sound of the Lord God as he was walking in the garden in the cool of the day, and they hid from the Lord God amongst the trees of the garden. But the Lord God called to them, saying, "Where are you?" The man answered, "I heard you in the garden, and I was afraid because I was naked, so I hid." And he said, "Who told you that you were naked? Have you eaten from the tree that I commanded you not to eat from?" The man said, "The woman you put here with me, she gave me some fruit from the tree, and I ate it." Then the Lord God said to the woman, "What is this that you have done?" The woman said, "The serpent deceived me, and I ate." So the Lord God said to the serpent, "Because you have done this, cursed are you above all the livestock and all the wild animals. You will crawl on your belly and eat dust all the days of your life. And I will put enmity between you and the woman, and between your offspring and hers. He will crush your head, and you will strike at his heel."
Oh, see. blessed. The angel of the Lord called to Abraham from heaven a second time and said, I swear by myself, declares the Lord, that because you have done this and not withheld your son, your only son, I will surely bless you and make your descendants as numerous as the stars in the sky and as the sand on the seashore. Your descendants will take possession of the cities of their enemies. And through your offspring, all nations on earth will be blessed because you have obeyed me.
Thank you. a branch will bear fruit. The Spirit of the Lord will rest on you. The Spirit of wisdom and of understanding. The Spirit of counsel and of power. The Spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord. And he will delight in the fear of the Lord. He will not judge by what he sees with his eyes, or decide by what he hears with his ears. But with righteousness he will judge the needy. With justice he will give decision to the poor of the earth. He will strike the earth with the rod of his mouth. With the breath of his lips he will slay the wicked. Righteous will be his belt, and faithfulness the sash around his waist. The wolf will live with the lamb. The leopard will lie down with the goat. The calf and the lion are yearning together, and the little child will lead them. The cow will feed with the bear. Their young will lie down together, and the lion will eat straw like the ox. The viper will play near the hole of the cobra, and the young child will put his hand into the viper's nest. They will neither harm nor destroy on all my holy mountain, for the earth will be full of the knowledge of the Lord as the waters of the sea.
Even Elizabeth, your relative,
relative is going to have a child in her old age, and she who was said to be barren is in her sixth month.
Analyze what it is that we are celebrating. when Pope Julius I authorized December 25th to be celebrated as the birthday of Jesus in AD 353. Who would have thought that it would become something like this today? When Professor Charles Follen lit candles on the first Christmas tree in America in 1832, who would have ever thought that the decoration would become as elaborate as we have today? It is a long time since 1832, longer still from 353 AD. Longer still from the dark night, brightened by that special star. Yet we approach December the 25th again. It gives us another opportunity to pause in the midst of all the excitement and to celebrate with elaborate decorations and expensive commercialization which surround Christmas today. All I am trying to do is to burst your bubbles out today. Let me give you an example of this. One fine morning, a person began with a stick of pure white hard candy. White to symbolize the virgin birth and the sinless nature of Jesus, and hard to symbolize the solid rock, the foundation of the church, and firmness of the promises of God. The candy maker made the candy in the form of a J to represent the precious name of Jesus. It could also represent the staff of the Good Shepherd with which he reaches the fallen humanity, people like you and me. After he made this candy, he thought it was a little plain. So the candy maker stained it with red stripes. He used three small stripes for the blood that was shed on Calvary, so we could have the promise of eternal life. Do you know what happened to that candy? Now it has become the candy cane. Meaningless decoration seen at Christmas time on Christmas trees. But the meaning is still there for those who have eyes to see and ears to hear. We pray that St. Paul will again be used to witness to the wonder of Jesus. Henry Nguyen, who is one of the Roman Catholic spiritualists, in an article in Oxford Review said, "I realized that songs, good feelings, beautiful liturgies, nice presents, big dinners, and many sweet words do not make Christmas. Christmas is saying yes to something beyond all emotions and feelings. Christmas is saying yes to a hope based on God's initiative, which has nothing to do with what I think or feel. Christmas is believing that the salvation of the world is God's work, not yours and mine." I heard a story of a woman who was doing her last Christmas shopping in a crowded mall. She was tired of fighting the crowd. She was tired standing in lines. She was tired fighting her way down the aisles looking for the gift that she had to give to other people. Her arms were full of bulky packages when the elevator door opened. It was full. The occupants of the elevator grudgingly tightened ranks to allow a small space so that this woman could get it. As soon as the door closed of the elevator, she blurted out, "Whoever is responsible for this whole Christmas thing ought to be arrested, strung up, and shot." A few others nodded. And there was somebody who said from the behind, "Don't worry, they already crucified him." See, this is the kind of feelings that we have when we come to Christmas. We need to remember who is responsible for the whole Christmas. It is all about how God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son. When I look at the Christmas celebrations, I always wonder about the shepherds. They fascinate me. Their emotions, their wonder, their restlessness. Before we can even consider the shepherds, please bear in mind certain basic facts. There are certain basic facts about Christianity we need to remember. Christianity, in its purest form, is nothing more than seeing Jesus. Christian service, in its purest form, is nothing more than imitating Him whom you see. To see His majesty and to imitate Him, that is the sum total of Christianity. Now let's look at the shepherds. Shepherds remind of the word interruption. I love the word interruption. It is not a good word. We don't want interruptions in our lives. Particularly in the class when I teach, I don't like interruptions. But do you know that the greatest interruption happened at Christmas? Eternity interrupted time. Divinity interrupted carnality. Heaven interrupted the earth in the fall of a day. Ask the shepherds at Bethlehem. We don't know much about them. We don't even know how many they were, and their ages, and how many were there on duty. One thing we can safely assume, they had no expectations of excitement. These are sheep they are watching. This is also a night shift. Their greatest challenge is to stay awake. These men expected no excitement, nor did they want any. And excitement for them was bad news. Wolves, mountain lions, poachers. But shepherds really enjoy the predictable. Their singular aim was this. The next day morning, they want to go home and tell their wives, nothing happened last night. Just because they wanted a calm night. However, did not mean they will get one. Just because you want a calm life, don't bank on it. The minute you sink down in the easy chair of life, the heaven pushes the remote and changes the channel. The financial aid office will say, no. The doctor would say, you have cancer. The boss says, you're fired. The test grade says F. The auto mechanic would say, oh, it's totaled. The auto insurance will say, expired. I'm reminded of a passage from the scriptures, Old Testament, Isaiah 45:7. He says, God's doing very well. I formed the light and created darkness. I bring prosperity and create disaster. I, the Lord, do all these things. It sounds like an interruption in our lives. And look at the initial response of the shepherds. They were terrified. They were afraid. The interruption caused them fear, distress, and anxiety. This was a tremendous change in their situation. They were not prepared for such excitement. Change always brings fear before it brings faith. We assume the worst before we look for the best. God interrupts our lives with something we have never seen before. Rather than praise, we panic. We interrupt the presence of a problem as the absence of God. And be schooled. Remember Isaiah? In chapter 6 of the book of Isaiah, he went to the temple. He has been going to the temple all his life. The last person he wanted to see in the temple was God. And God shows up. And then he cries out, I am a man of unclean lips. I live among the people of unclean lips. But then he lingered on. He stayed on. So that the hot coal could touch him. To make him okay. When I look at the shepherds, the same thought comes to my mind. It is a good thing that the shepherds lingered. Otherwise, they would have missed the rest of the announcement of the angels. I hope you will do the same what the shepherds did. Linger near the manger. The stench may be intolerable, but I promise you, it is real work. The biggest news is still the best news. Christ entered the world. As a result, we can enter His. You may ask, you mean to tell me God became a baby, then He was born in a stable? Yes, this is precisely what I am saying. Listen to the biggest interruption of all time. The Omnipotent, in one instant, made Himself He who had been spirit became perishable. He who was larger than universe became an embryo. He who sustains the whole world with a word chose to be dependent upon the nourishment of a teenage girl. God as a fetus, holiness sleeping in a womb, the creator of life being created. God was given eyebrows, elbows, two kidneys, and a spleen. He stretched against the walls and floated in the amniotic fluid of his mouth. He came as no flash of light, as an unapproachable conqueror. But as one whose first cries were heard by a peasant girl and a sleepy carpenter. The hands that first held him were emaciated, calloused, and dirty. No silk, no ivory, no hype, no party, no hoopla. Were it not for the shepherds, there would have been no reception. And were it not for a group of stargazers, there would have been no gifts. Think of Jesus in this light. For some, it may be irreverent. It is not something that we don't want to do. We want to romanticize Christmas story and sanitize the manger. Christmas is forcing us to stay with reality. There are going to be many interruptions in our lives. But the message is clear and simple. In the midst of our interruptions, our pain and our struggles, Christmas is asking us to linger on a little longer in the manger with the baby who has come to be with us as a man. It is easier for us to keep this baby who has come into the world at a distance. packaged and predictable. But this Christmas, don't do that. Let him be as human as he intended to be. Let him get into the mire and muck of our lives. Because if only you let him in, he can pull us out. In all interruptions, God is with us as Emmanuel. And his promise is true. The promise simply is this: Lo, I am with you always, till the end of age. That is the presence that we celebrate today. And that is the hope we have. And that is the promise of a person who will never break his promise. And that is the blessed hope in which we celebrate our Christmas. Amen.
Thank you.
few time together with the choir so that we can get to know each other and also we could have some fellowship. There will be refreshments served downstairs after the service. Tomorrow is our Sunday school celebration. I know many of you have stayed away, even our members have stayed away because of the scare the weatherman has put into the minds of the people. So I know many of our members called and said they will not be here because of that. According to the severity of the weather, we will try to do the best we can tomorrow. I know the children are very excited about their play, but still what we will do is we will play it by ear tomorrow morning, how the situation is, and there will be phone calls going back and forth if the weather is going to be bad. 24th evening, we have a service at 7:30. And Christmas Day service will be at 9:30 a.m. And I wish you all a very Merry Christmas and a very healthy, prosperous New Year. Thank you for being with us. One of the pieces I had written, this is my first composition, and was written years and years ago. Mohan, if you want to come and sing with us, you can feel the welcome because you sang it years and years ago.
Thank you.
how the birth of Jesus Christ came about. His mother Mary was pledged to be married to Joseph. But before they came together, she was found to be with child through the Holy Spirit. Because Joseph, her husband, was a righteous man and did not want to expose her to public disgrace, he had in mind to divorce her quietly. But after he had considered this, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream and said, "Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary home as your wife, because what is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will give birth to a son, and you are to give him the name of Jesus, because he will save his people from their sins." All this took place to fulfill what the Lord had said through the prophet. "The virgin will be with child, and will give birth to a son, and they will call him Emmanuel, which means God with us." When Joseph woke up, he did what the angel of the Lord had commanded him, and took Mary home as his wife. But he had no union with her until she gave birth to a son, and he gave him the name
Jesus.
out in the fields nearby, keeping watch over their flocks at night. An angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid. I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all people. Today, in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is Christ the Lord. This will be a sign to you. You will find a baby wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger." Suddenly, a great company of the heavenly host appeared with the angel, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to men on whom his favor rests." When the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let's go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has told us about." So they hurried off and found Mary and Joseph and the baby, who was lying in the manger.
Wise men are led by the star to Jesus. After Jesus was born in Bethlehem in Judea, during the time of King Herod, Magi from the east came to Jerusalem and asked, "Where is the one who has been born King of the Jews? We saw his star in the east and have come to worship him." When King Herod heard this, he was disturbed, and all of Jerusalem with him. When he had called together all the people's chief priests and teachers of the law, he asked them where the Christ was to be born. "In Bethlehem, in Judea," they replied, "for this is what the prophet has written. But you, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are by no means least among the rulers of Judah. For out of you will come a ruler who will be the shepherd of my people Israel." Then Herod called the Magi secretly and found out from them the exact time the star had appeared. He sent them to Bethlehem and said, "Go and make a careful search for the child. As soon as you find him, report to me, so that I too may go and worship him." After they had heard the king, they went on their way, and the star they had seen in the east went ahead of them, until it stopped over the place where the child was. When they saw the star, they were overjoyed. On coming to the house, they saw the child with his mother Mary, and they bowed down and worshipped him. Then they opened their treasures and presented him with gifts of gold and incense.
Yeah. He was with God in the beginning. Through him, all things were made. Without him, nothing was made that has been made. In him was life, and that life was the light of men. The light that shines in the darkness, but the darkness has not understood it. There came a man who was sent from God. His name was John. He came as a witness to testify concerning that light, so that through him all men might believe. He himself was not the light. He came only as a witness to the light. The true light that gives light to every man was coming into the world. He was in the world, and though the world was made through him, the world did not recognize him. He came to that which was his own, but his own did not receive him. Yet to all who received him, to those who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God, children born not of natural descent, nor of human decision or a husband's will, but born of God. The Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us. We have seen his glory, the glory of the one and only, who came from the Father, full of grace and truth.
Oh, about lessons and carols, I thought I'd leave you with an interpretation of the colors of Christmas. Everybody knows that the colors of Christmas are red and green. Pick any two and I'll say, yeah, red and green. There is a commercial aspect of the red that we see. Unfortunately, Santa has the raw end of the stick on that one. It was a commercial behemoth, a soda company. I'm not going to name it. Begins with C, ends with A, begins with C, ends with A. It was because of that that Santa now has this ungodly red suit. Think about those poor Santa helpers in India and Thailand who have to be in that woolen red suit in the middle of a feisty, sweaty December night. That's the power of marketing. But I'm not here to talk to you about the red in that beverage that got transplanted on Santa's suit. This story comes from the British Isles. The red and the green come from the holly shrub. You see, when winter comes in and gets its grip on all of nature, all of the rest of the trees have given up their leaf-generating operations. They have called it quits. The holly says, I'm not going to go with that trend. It's a broad-leafed shrub, and yet it flaunts its green. Borrowing from what Achan said this evening, God interrupts life as usual. The rest of nature has gone to sleep, but the holly still shows its green. Its resilience, its defiance, its working against conventional wisdom. That is what we celebrate green for in Christmas. The same little shrub puts out red berries. So a Christian's life is not one of conventional, non-interrupted progress. The journey from Bethlehem to the cross was not easy. But we didn't see Christ moping around. He celebrated life. And that is what the red is all about. Resilience, defiance, celebration. The two colors that we celebrate during Christmas. I'd like all of us to leave with that seed of a thought, to try and center around and focus around those qualities. Resilience, thumbing your nose against conventional wisdom, because you have been called, all of us have been called, be different. Let us pray. Almighty God, you have given your only begotten Son to take our nature upon him and to be born of a pure virgin. Grant that we, who have been born again and made your children by adoption and grace, may daily be renewed by your Holy Spirit, through our Lord Jesus Christ, to whom, with you, and the same Spirit be honor and glory, now and for all of this Christmas season and for the year to come. Amen.
Let us pray. Dear God and Father, you sent your beloved Son to redeem us from sin and death, to make us heirs in him of everlasting life, that when he comes again in power and great triumph to judge the world, we may, without shame or fear, rejoice to behold his appearing. Dear Father, you gave Jesus Christ, your only Son, to be born for us, who by thy mighty power of the Holy Spirit has made perfect man of flesh of the Virgin Mary, his mother, so that we may be delivered from the bondage of sin and receive power to become children, children of your Most High. Watch over us, most gracious Father. Give us strength and peace in this time that your child comes to us. Guide and direct us in all that we do, that everything that we do will be to your glory. We ask for peace in this time, most merciful Father. Keep watch over us, dear Lord, for those who work, those who weep. Give thy angels charge over those who sleep. Tend to the sick, Lord Christ. Give rest to the weary. Bless the dying. Soothe the suffering. Pity the afflicted. Shield the joyous. All for thy love's sake. Amen.
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 O God, from whom all holy desires, all good counsel and all just works do proceed, give unto thy servant that peace which the world cannot give, that our hearts may be set to obey thy commandment, and also that by thee, we being defended from the fear of all enemies, may pass our time in rest and quietness through the merits of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, the fellowship of the Holy Spirit watch over us now and forevermore. Amen. Let us bless the Lord.
Thanks be to God.